Funny thing is that I've been making maybe around 800 films over the past 15 years, and I've been like documenting a lot of things in my life, which are basically musicians and rituals that I've been encountering and researching. But I've been documenting so much, and I've always been very my life has been very hectic, and I cannot stop. It's my way to exchange, to dialogue with the world, has been to really to film it with a camera in my hands. But now, obviously, that relationship with my own images, and in general with images in our society, is very tricky, because we are surrounded. Not only surrounded, we are invaded in our imaginaries about images all the time, everywhere. And I've been deeply thinking about this, how to find spaces without being bombarded in front of a screen, bombarded by advertisement in the streets, or basically, how do we escape that intensity of the techno image taking over our own imagination? And it's a very interesting moment in time, because I believe we are like, we've been letting so much of our own freedom being sort of like cocooned, or in a sense cared by this external technology, and to the point that we lost a lot of the human relationship, and I would even say cosmic relationship with reality, little by little. We are reinventing it also in a way through those technology, but I do believe what's definitely missing, it's a very long talk to have, is the element of mystery. How do we rebuild mystery in our relationship? How do we basically accept to not know something? How do we basically allow ourselves to be surprised? How do we allow this data world to not give us all the answers when we need them? How do we basically find a better relationship with technology? That's what I've been caring about a lot in the past few years, especially. And even more few months, especially in this time of like insane crisis, which is definitely not at the end of it. We're probably at the very beginning of larger chaotic moments in our generation. But it's a very important topic. How do we regain another type of relationship with our bodies, with the others, and with mystery, which is basically, to me, the poetry at stake, at the heart of our relationship with reality. We don't want to know everything. We should not know everything, We should allow those spaces. I do not come from an anthropological background. I'm not an ethnomusicologist, and I'm not studying the other. Or in a sense, I'm probably just studying myself through the others. So to say, I'm not interested. I think, we should be really careful of that trap of trying to depict, to explain something that is definitely foreign for us, we are outsiders in so many relationships all around us, and I think this is a very beautiful thing. And in a sense, by documenting rituals and ceremony, I've been very fascinated at first by how do people deal with the invisible in their own culture? How do they deal with those higher forces that they might call God or spirits or Pachamama or so many different names in a sense, but it's very much the same eternal question at the core of humankind. What's that other thing? What's that reality we live in? And how does it work? How do we especially maintain the harmony with it? And I think it's always very important to go back to those ancient wisdom of, you know, indigenous people, where we have a very common answer to this idea of why do you ritualize, coming from a lot of indigenous ancestors, which is we ritualize so that the sky do not fall. We ritualize so that the sun shows up the next morning. We basically maintain forces in a cosmic harmony. And that relationship, which has been highly troubled in the past few centuries, is very much at the core also of my own relationship with images, and how do we want, through images and through documentaries, to show the world, show the others. How do we offer to the viewer a certain window into something he does not know and he does not participate in, maybe? Even though most of those films are really made for the community we work with, which is the first thing. We make those films with my wife Priscilla, and we bring them back to the people who filmed, you know, and we let them use those films as they want. But more than that, then you offer a window for some other people, which might be very far away, on that action, on that gathering, on that spiritual experience that some other people, which might at first look very different from them, are having. And I do not, I've been trying to find a good balance in between which information do I want to give and which information do I do not want to give in that. I don't be, because at the very core of those spiritual experiences, it's not about the intellect, it's not about the information, it's about something which goes way beyond the relationship, a cerebral type of relationship with reality. It's actually much more present in the body, and especially in a sort of like transcendental form of body. And that form of relationship, how do you try to basically transfer this energy through images and sounds? And so I've been trying to find a way that there is not really very much any information in the films themselves, because that is too limited. I would prefer people to actually, if the viewer wants to really know about this place or that place, basically you just look for it and find a 300 pages book by a guy who's been living there maybe for 10 years. And that's great. And that's an amazing document. And you might have many answers. But I'm not looking to give answers. I'm basically much more interested in how do you create another form of relationship through the medium image, inside a ritual, inside a ceremony. How do we understand also cinema as well, simply as an act of transcendental communion, in a way? How do we basically find this balance? And I think that's basically what I've been trying to experiment, especially for the past 10 years. How do we offer a canvas for the viewer as well to have his own experience, his own spiritual experience, which is in a sense goes through the freedom we give to the viewer to complete the film itself, in a sense, you know. So those films are very, very incomplete, because they have to be completed. And there is not one answer to that. There is as many answers as there is in viewers. It is very important. And so I do see those spiritual experiments that I participate, and Priscilla, my wife as well, participate with me in those different circles all around the world. We see them as basically doors to another form of relationship to reality. And I do believe that the fact of filming those events do not ruin the vibe, you know, or basically not chill the energy. There is actually a very fascinating thing going through it, is the frame of a spirit might still contain the spirit. Obviously, what I mean by saying that I'm not that much researching the others as I am researching myself is that obviously reality is a subjective experience, and that's very, very important to state this sometimes again, especially in a society which is going mad around the idea of truth. There is something very important we have to remember, that of course reality is a subjective experience. We just find, as a society, a common ground to live together, you know, and not have completely different visions of it. But still, it's my own experience going through there, and I'm never gonna say, oh, these are exactly the way that those people deep in the Amazon are ritualizing. This is basically not the case. That shaman did that healing session on that specific day with that person, and I was there, and it's the way I filmed it. And this is the result, you know, take it or leave it. But basically, I'm sure there is some elements in that result, in that short film, in that audio recording, that might communicate with you and that you could bring further, which is very important for me. Maybe something important for me to state is that all the work I've been doing has always been under open source licenses, which is very important to understand in a relationship with shamanic languages. Basically, the digital age and the digital tools appear to me and to many of us, obviously now, as a reintegration of the ancient shamanic tools, except they have a very different shape, but they have as well very probably the same power inside them. We just have to decode this better. And that's why obviously there is analogy going on more and more around the hacker and the shaman, you know, because in a sense the hacker is the one who goes behind on the other side of the curtain, you know, as the shaman is the one who knows this is only a theater, because he's the only one who can go behind the curtain. The others are not conscious about that. So there is always been this deep relationship in ancient tribal lives with the cosmic energies, which are sort of like maintained in harmony through different forms of ritual, and obviously through one or a few specific persons who have maybe more those abilities to go there. And I do see as a very interesting extension that in this global tribe that we live in, and I don't know if you know that fantastic book by Marshall McLuhan, War and Peace in a Global Village, which is such a great book to reread now, actually. There is a very different and very continuous as well, in a sense, relationship with shamanism, because in a way, we have those abilities to explore through our technological languages very much a transcendental, experimental relationship with reality, re-engage ourselves in the, let me phrase it like this, maybe it's like a decoding, recoding of reality. Basically, it's an intense remix of all those ancient wisdoms being nowadays looked at at high speed, obviously, and touched at and reintegrated in our tissues of the global hybrids we are. And it's taking very different forms, but I do believe there is a responsibility that artists, creators, and I do have very wide understanding of the idea of the artist. I do believe that we have this responsibility to explore those realms, and exploring those realms, those shamanic technological explorations, have to respect some of those obvious symbiotic relationships that exist already in nature, which are basically everything is moving. There is no end. There is no object, finished object. There is only transient objects. Things are moving from one to the other, and it's just an extraordinary acceleration we are living now. And obviously, when things got so fast, some people are scared and want to stop the rhythm and basically want to stop exchanging, declaring this is not yours, this belongs to me, this is the limit, this is, you know, what this tradition is, and we should not move this forward, except that vision is a very westernized vision compared to the indigenous ancient spiritual ways to relate to reality, which is, well, it's always been moving. There is no tradition in that sense. There's only evolution, constant evolution from a generation to a generation, because we have been, as humankind, living for most of our time in an oral form of culture, especially. And the book and the written object is very recent. And I do see a possibility in our digital era to bring back that ability of the oral relationship to the others, which means the mistake, which means the possibility that things are not going to be the same, which is regaining a little bit of that element of mystery in all our exchanges. We're going to finish, we are basically well on the way to finish like robots. How do you push the limits of cinema, and how do you expand towards what some people call expanded cinema? But basically, how do you go beyond even the idea of cinema and reach towards other languages? And I see this as a very, very important topic of our society nowadays, especially accelerated by the crisis that we live in. We might very much see, as we see already in France, that the institutions are going to struggle a lot to maintain the way they were functioning with different forms of arts, you know, musical institutions, cinema, galleries, and so on. But in that sense, I see this as a great opportunity to actually reconsider languages, the artistic languages, and stop seeing them as separated from each other. Which I believe as well is a quite recent way to look at it. In a sense, we've been specializing different notions of creativity into so many different genres and sub-genres that it's quite unhealthy, in a sense that we should regain a dialogue, a much more rich dialogue in between the different languages. And that is what's happening with the digital tools. Digital tools makes you easily create a sound from an image, you know, and vice versa, and actually much more. We have seen that. You might have heard the symphony of the virus, you know, stuff like that. So basically, there is a very interesting transformation at stake through the use of digital tools. And what I'm excited about is to explore those realms by finding protocols. And when I say protocols, we've been exploring different forms of experimentations, live performances that we call live cinema. We did one last Thursday in Paris, just before the curfew. We gathered more than 200 people actually in one venue. And there was five different musicians and dancers participating, and we were showing different films from different rituals, but we were all doing it, improvising. So we had just like, we gave ourselves 2 hours, and over those 2 hours, we remixed basically our own work, and we had people interacting with it, dancers, musicians, and so on. And for us, it's very interesting because the type of relationship that we create with the viewer is not a narrative, a classical form of narration. That's definitely something I want to escape, which I believe is very much part of the way we look at images nowadays. You know, there is a very strong form of narration towards the viewer, which I think disempowers the viewer very much, where you are trapped into an idea, sort of. Unfortunately, most of the documentary cinema nowadays is very much a propaganda form of cinema, where you try to convince someone about an idea. You know, those ideas might be great or might be terrible, but that's not the point. The point is that you should not try to convince people about an idea. This is fucked up. We ended up in a society which is very weird in that relationship. This is very obvious to me, but it's not obvious for many people, maybe, you know. So what I'm excited about, how do we regain, again, those other form of spaces and explore those spaces where we let people engage with their body, for example, in a different way. So for example, we almost never show our films in cinemas, in cinema venues. Why? Because I do believe the cinema venues have this type of like, I would call it egregore, but basically it has this energy field that fixes very much, very often, the way that people are expecting to see an image. You know what I mean? People are sitting on a seat and they expect something, because they've been sitting in that seat or in such form of seat for so long. But if you move that relationship and bring the viewer into a different space where he's not in a seat, he's on the floor, or he's not in a cinema, he's in an old factory, where if you move all those different elements, if you move the relationship also that you have with the audience, that basically the artist does not show up on stage at the very last minute, you know, in the sort of like tension, to create a tension, to get a mystery around him. No, I mean, we are often very much welcoming everybody in the room, talking with everybody before even we start. So we try to create this other form of relationship, and all those elements are going to have a deep influence on the experience of the viewer. The experience of the viewer suddenly becomes way less something where the viewer is waiting for something. But I think we're trying to push the viewer into a much more creative mode where we want her or him to engage and complete, as I was saying before, in a sense, with his own body, to engage and see how those images might touch something interestingly deep in terms of archetype. You were mentioning Jung just before, but I do believe that there is all those archetypes that we carry around and that they are triggered in a way or another by the music and the images that we might make and we might offer to people. And as open as those are, as open is the film itself for this experience, the more open it is, basically, the more the deeper it's gonna go probably for the participant, for the viewer, you know, to really engage and work. And then in a sense, go back to this very ancient way of healing together, because that's where it comes from. Obviously, I do believe, I've always believed since I started to get to research on this more than 10 years ago, I started to really go deep into sacred music and why do we play music, for which reason did we start to basically have this this conversation, you know, this those sounds emitting, why did we emit sounds as a community? I do believe we create sounds, we play music because we want to complete the dialogue with the invisible, we want to respond to something which is that we don't understand, but which is obviously there. And in that game of reality, there is this balance of forces. So those healing aspects of sound and ceremonies goes back to the beginning of humankind very much. And that's what we're seeing now. We might name it the renewal of spirituality. We might see only fake shamans around. We might think this is just bullshit because it's just everybody is healing on his or her side and not really regaining a more communal form of gathering and so on. But no, I believe this is where history is bringing us back. We have to re-understand art and creation as the first healing tool for humankind in its relationship with everything else around. And so it's obvious, it's very obvious for me that this is the story that we live through now, you know. We've been so sick as a society, but basically we've been sick by expanding this society on a global scale. What did we find by going global? We find especially different forms of so-called cultures, and little by little we realize, and especially at the end of the 20th century, beginning of the 21st century, we have realized that all those different approaches to the invisible are very similar. And in that similarity, we go back to this idea that Jung was mentioning as the unus mundus, or basically that there is a common ground, a sort of like original unified reality at the very core of our reality now. And I do believe we are regaining this one. We are re-understanding it in this accelerative process. It's a very fascinating time. So obviously what I'm excited about, just to finish on our work, is to explore those languages, to get away from any form of institutions. I really don't care about I'm sorry to say, film festivals and all those different boxes, in a sense, because I do believe we have to really go beyond now and regain some local interactions, rework in a much more humble relationship with the communities and create all together. And by doing so, we need as well, the artist needs to get over his ego and open his hand. And hopefully I've been trying to do this on my side by also doing everything for free and releasing everything for free. We don't sell anything, which means we have a very sometimes difficult economical relationship in that reality, but that's part of the game, you know. If I really want to go deep into this relationship of how do cinema meets the other art forms to recreate new forms of rituals, well, I do have also to understand that remix has always been the key of reality. Reality has always been remixing itself, so I have to let it go. As humankind, as a global society now, the way we deal with death is so wrong that we are getting fucking lost, especially when you have a virus going around a bit. And we've seen that this extraordinary, completely mad reaction, which went very fast all around the world against this virus, shows how much we are unprepared to die. In that sense, the relationship with death has always been dealt with in ancient ways through different forms of rituals. I've been obviously very much studying the use of psychoactive plants in shamanic rituals, in tribes and so on. And one thing you realize in a deep psychoactive experience is that this is the greatest preparation for death. In a sense, that's how we could see ceremonies on a larger scale, not only psychoactive ceremonies, even though psychoactive uses are very powerful to break through, in a sense. We could say that ceremonies, in a sense, are basically ways to re-earth the moment of death and to deal with it, to appease it, to find a better balance. That's what we see in initiation rituals, you know, in a sense, where you need at some point a deep, violent experience as human being to go from one stage to the other. That's why we see the presence for so long of initiation rituals that in general are rituals that young people between 12 and 16, of course a bit more here and there, are going through. Those rituals are determined to break something in your existence, to really go from one step to another. And that is one of the key elements that our global society has completely lost. We've been obviously artists, alternatives, ways of living, of being, still trying to regain that, you know, let's think about the 60s and so on. But there is this deep need to re-understand death on a different scale, because if not, we end up with those completely fucked up ideas that are slowly taking power in the techno power that we live in, obviously, you know. All the everything related to, you know, immortality and so on is so wrong because it does not understand the cycle. There is this obvious cycle of life and death and life and death and life and death again and again and again. There is no end. This is such an obvious experience anybody can have as long as you do a little bit of effort nowadays. Then go deep into rituals, in trance, into different forms to relate to reality. There is just so many opportunities, you know. I'm not talking only about Amazonian, Westernian, you know, Western form of like experiences, but just like go deeper into meditation and so on. This is very probably the conclusion you're going to have, you know. There is no end. I think it's the same problem that we have at the beginning of how do we approach technology. We have a binary form of technology, zero and one. And this is, in a sense, the extension of a Judeo-Christian idea of good and bad. So in a way, we lack another element. We lack the chaotic element. What we call in the digital age, the bug. So in that sense, we could see the bug as a chaotic living element, which from time to time disrupts the machine and bring it to another level. If we had a technology which was okay with it, okay with the bug, okay with the chaos, because you need chaos to create reality and vice versa, then we will be in a very different position. But we have a hard time. And obviously the control of the society is much easier just staying in that binary relationship, good or bad. And I think this is very important that we find ways. There are so many possibilities, poetical approaches to technologies and so on. So we maintain mistake at the core of the machine, you know? Because nothing's perfect, mon ami. And that's very much what maybe my last word could be, is that we have to respect much more who we are as humankind and not pretend we're perfect. That's completely fucked up. We make many mistakes. We just have to allow ourselves to make those mistakes and repair them together, you know, and be much more generous towards each other, much more. And I think what we see nowadays is extreme use of hate through social networks is a reaction towards a humankind that we don't understand anymore. Well, towards actually, we don't understand the living. We don't understand life, it seems. And obviously it's going mad. We have to regain that. And there is many, many paths. But it's also our own responsibility to explore those as artists, as creators, as filmmakers, musicians, and dancers, and so on. We have to re-explore how do we create together and how do we heal our communities. That's very much the mission to me. You know, if you go deep into the Yi Qing or the I Ching, if you start to study the Tarot, if you start to study astrology, if you start to also study palm hand reading, if you basically bring all those different knowledges, you know, together, well, there is something quite stunning, is that they correspond. There is something obviously which corresponds in your life, in your experience, this embodied experience that your soul is having for now. There is obviously so many correspondences that Well, you can use the word destiny if you want. I like the word mission. It's, I feel, you know, it's all about finding your own mission. And actually, little by little, the more you go into life, you realize that the mission was there from the beginning. You might just didn't pay enough attention. It's really a matter of paying attention. Pay attention, and you will see that it makes sense. It's stunning. Everything makes sense. That's the most beautiful thing. You look back, I'm 41 now, you know, and sometimes I look back and I'm like, shit, I don't know why I did this and that and that and that. It all makes sense. I am who I am now because I had all those different experiences. I had all those mistakes as well, and I have to respect them so much because they are part of me and my own evolution. I guess the quest is about trying to look closer to that, to the patterns of life in and outside of you.